Okay, well, thank you for everybody for coming along. I'll just share my screen and then I'll hand over to Steph to get started. Can you see the slides at the moment?
Yep.
Fantastic. Okay.
Great. All right. Well, welcome. Welcome everybody. It's exciting. Happy Thursday or any day from your time zone. And thank you, R-Ladies Ottawa, for the invitation to join you and talk about using Arrow in R. This is an approximately 2-hour workshop. We'll see, or we hope we have about 2 hours of content for you, and we'll just see how we go in terms of getting through it. And I'm just going to start with a few minutes of introductions and housekeeping, and then we're going to jump right in so that we have lots of time for coding and for learning together. So to start, my name is Stephanie Hazlitt. I am a data scientist turned manager turned, I don't know, person who just talks about data a lot. In my day job, I work for BC Stats in the province of British Columbia. It's the statistical agency for the province. And in my non-day job, I still use R as much as I can. And I'll turn it over to Nick for Nick to introduce themselves.
Yeah, so hi, I'm Nick. I'm a data scientist turned software engineer, but still data scientist because that stuff is fun as well. I've been working on Arrow for about 3 years in total. I'm a software engineer, mainly in R, little bits of Python, but like R is where my heart is because it's got the coolest people. Yeah, that's me.
Great. Yeah, and I thought we would start with, before we jump to the welcome slide, I was, you know, especially given we're spending 2 hours together, an opportunity for you to introduce yourselves. I know cameras are off for various reasons, which I totally get, but if you wanted to pop into the chat, you know, either your name or something about you, why you're interested in Arrow, if you're already using Arrow, if there's things you love about Arrow or things you don't love. I will invite everyone to use the chat function in Zoom now. And yeah, just take a minute to see who our ladies of Ottawa have pulled together this evening or this afternoon, depending on your time zone, or to chat about Arrow.
Yeah, that would be really cool to see.
I might wait just for a few seconds. If people don't want to do it, that's fine as well. Oh, here we go.
Awesome. So it looks like so far we've got a mix of people who have used Arrow before and haven't used Arrow before. So that's great. So hopefully we'll have stuff that'll be kind of interesting at kind of everybody in different levels.
Yeah, nice. Sounds great. All right, Nick. Let's move on to what we're going to do today. So today we are, this is definitely an introduction to Arrow. It starts from the very beginning. So for some of you that are already using Arrow, I'm sure there'll be some review and hopefully that will be useful as well. Apache Arrow as an ecosystem and the Arrow for R package actually do a tremendous number of different things in a data workflow. Today, we're going to be focusing on using the Arrow for R package to work with larger than memory data sets on your workstation or laptop or machine. And we're going to talk a little bit about how to get the best performance with your tabular data, locally or on your machine. And then we'll finish off by talking about some places that you can get more information or continue learning after our time today. The format of the workshop is slides, as you can already tell, because there's already slides up, which are available at the link in the slide. We'll double check that the links work as we go and at the end of the workshop. And the design is Nick and I will both talk a little bit with some hopefully useful slides. We're going to code a little bit that people can code along if they want, or you can just watch and code later. It's really up to you. And then we are going to work pretty hard to take some natural breaks and have time for questions and discussion as we go. So I think as we started to cover in the pre-section, to get set up, you have a couple of options. You can just follow along, not just, you can follow along with the slides and have a script or and just watch. Or if you want, you can grab a clone of the repository where all the slides are made, which is at the link below there. And Nick and I will be using RStudio for the coding today, but of course you can be using any IDE of choice. And the data that we're going to be using is available. Hopefully some of you have downloaded it if you want to follow along with the full data set. There's a code chunk there that you can, if you haven't downloaded it and you want it, you can actually run that code chunk now. And as Nick said, it will take a little bit of time because it is a 9 GB data set. But hopefully by the time we're finished talking and we get to the really good bits, I will have downloaded. This is a good time to highlight actually that, and Nick could probably do this because they're sharing their screen, but all of the code chunks in the slides, you can just copy straight from the slide and plunk it into your console if you want to grab the data. The data set is the data set that's actually used in the R for Data Science chapter on Arrow. It's hosted in a AWS bucket by the authors of R for Data Science. It originally comes from, we'll talk about it in a bit, but it originally comes from an open data catalog based in Seattle. And if you're working in, and if you don't want to have the data locally or you're on your work machine and you're kind of have some friction there, thanks to R-Ladies Ottawa for setting up a Posit Cloud instance. I believe that Melissa put the instructions in the chat earlier, so you can either scroll up, or if you've joined us a bit late, I'm sure they'll show up again. Or I think you can link, well, I think what we thought you could click on this URL and it should take you to an instance or a project. And once you've sort of logged in, you should see a start button. And that should spin up an instance of RStudio in the cloud with the packages already loaded and some data. It's not the full 9 GB of data because Posit Cloud is not really designed for large, big data work, but it's kind of a tiny example data set of the same data. So you'll get the same feel, but maybe not some of the large data wow factor. I think that's it. So I'm going to turn it over for Nick, who's going to start us off. Well, first, I should say, please use the chat and ask questions. It sounds like we have lots of volunteers from Our Ladies Ottawa to help. Nick and I will also be monitoring the chat when we're not teaching, and really invite folks to ask questions along the way. And if our moderators feel like that question should be sort of addressed right away, let's do it. Let's just make the time together work for everybody. And if you're having any IT challenges or any other things that we can change or alter on the fly to make your experience more comfortable, please let us know in the chat as well. And now I'll pass it over to Nick, and Nick can start with our introduction to Arrow.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Steph. I'm going to give a bit of an introduction to Arrow. So what it is, what is the project all about? I will say this is about 5-10 minutes. So if you want to get that data set downloaded, now is the perfect time, and hopefully it'll all be ready for when we get into the actual coding. Okay, so yeah, let's get started. So the first thing, I think a good question to ask is, what is Apache Arrow? Now, if you go to the Arrow website, you'll see this sentence here: a multi-language toolbox for accelerated data interchange and in-memory processing, which is quite the mouthful. And actually, a slightly more straightforward explanation, which I like, but we will be going into all of these things in more detail, is this idea that Arrow is designed to both improve the performance of analytical algorithms and the efficiency of moving data from one system or programming language to another. But let's go into that in a bit more detail. So the first thing to note is Apache Arrow, the project itself, is a specification rather than a library. And I will definitely get into that more of that in a moment. But the Arrow specification, it's all about describing a way of representing structured table-like data sets in memory. It's a standardized language agnostic specification, which means this standard has been implemented in multiple languages. And one of the key things about it is it's a columnar format. So a lot of kind of more traditional data formats are row-based. Arrow is column-based, and this can really help speed things up. But let's get to that in a second. Okay, so the first thing that I mentioned then is this idea of Arrow as a multi-language toolbox. So in this diagram here, we've got the Arrow specification that defines the standard at the very top level. And then at the level underneath on this middle kind of row there is the idea that Arrow has been implemented in multiple languages. So C++, JavaScript, Rust, and a whole load of others that aren't on this diagram here. And the one that's kind of important to us is the C++ implementation, but the R, Python, and actually Ruby Arrow versions basically provide bindings or wrappers around the C++ library, which means you don't have to know any C++ to work with Arrow's C++ library, which is good because anytime I try to use C++, I spend like about an hour and still haven't really got much done. So you don't have to know any C++ to be able to use it. Okay. So I mentioned this idea of accelerated data interchange, and this kind of comes back to this idea of having this standardized format. So if we don't have a standard, then if we want to pass data, say between R and Python or between different systems, we have to get it in a format that works for one system, copy it into some intermediate format, and then copy it into another one. Now, with smaller data sets, that's not necessarily a huge problem. But once you get really big data sets, that can slow things down. If you've got a long analytical pipeline, that could take up most of your processing time. So having this standard way of representing the data in memory means that, say, if I'm passing data between R and Python or between different systems, R can just say, hey, Python, this is where this Arrow data is in memory. Go find it there without having to copy things back and forth. So that's kind of one of the nice things of having this standard. And people will talk about Arrow and this idea of reducing serialization and deserialization or zero copy sharing. And this is all about not having to kind of just copy things back and forth. Okay. So one thing that I mentioned is this, the idea of a columnar format. And I just want to give you a bit of a kind of more concrete example to show you what that looks like. So this table at the top here, it could be like a data set relating to people that have connected to a server, different sessions on a server. So the first column is session ID, so a unique identifier for each session. The second column is timestamp, so that's the date and the time that that session was started. And the third session is source IP, so the IP address for the device that connected in that session. So this is in this kind of like two-dimensional table here. But actually, when we're thinking about how data is represented in memory, memory buffers are one-dimensional. We've just got this kind of sequential addresses in memory where we can store data. So traditionally, in row-based formats, we'd have it kind of like this image on the bottom left here. So this first row, where we've got this session ID, timestamp, and source IP from that very top row, the values would be put into the memory buffer sequentially, one after another, row by row. But in an Arrow memory buffer over here, they've been put in column by column. Now, the row kind of format is really efficient when you're working with what can be called like transactional kind of processes. So that's things like if you want to work with data one row at a time. But actually, a lot of the time when we're doing data analytics, we're doing things like, I just want to pull out these columns. I want to do some sort of aggregation. So I don't know, if I wanted to work out like the median time that somebody connected to the server, for example. So in a row-based format, if I wanted to just pull out the timestamp column to do some calculations, I'd have to jump from this second row to this fifth and so on. Whereas in a columnar format, what this means is, okay, I can go to this first value here. If I know how many of the values are in the column, I can kind of grab them all out at once. And also there are a lot of aspects of modern hardware that are designed to take advantage of a vectorization. So applying a function to multiple bits of data at a time. And so having things in this columnar format helps take advantage of that. Okay, but enough about the standard. I wanna talk now about the Arrow R package itself and what it can do. So this is from the README, and this is kind of, I've tried to kind of group it into a few different categories. So the first main category of things is that Arrow can read and write data and larger than memory data sets as well in a variety of different formats. One of them is CSV. So I think most people here will be familiar with CSV, super commonly used, comma separated value files. And Arrow can work efficiently with kind of like big CSV files. But actually another thing that's exciting about working with Arrow is that Arrow is compatible with Parquet. So Parquet is an alternative data format, and I don't want to talk about this too much because Steph will be talking more about this later. But it can be so, so good in speeding up analyses and have massive advantages over working with CSVs. So Arrow can work with Parquet files. In this kind of second chunk of things here, Arrow can analyze and process larger than memory data sets. And that's again, one of the kind of really big exciting things. So when I say a larger than memory data set, what I mean is, say for example, you've got a laptop with 16 gigabytes of RAM. If you've got a data set that's 16 gigabytes, you're not gonna be able to analyze that in R. And actually, even if you've got a data set that's say, I don't know, like 5-6 gigabytes, you can load it into your R session, but when you go to perform analysis on that, things are likely to grind to a halt or go really slowly. And this is one of the things that the way that Arrow is kind of implemented under the hood, it can kind of get around those kinds of problems. Another thing in that same kind of middle section is this idea that you can manipulate and analyze Arrow data with dplyr verbs. So when you're working with Arrow, if you're already familiar with dplyr, what that means is you can use a lot of the dplyr functions that you already know, and you don't have to learn a whole new framework to work with Arrow. Now, there's lots of other features that the Arrow R package has baked into it, and we're not going to be covering all of these today. There's just simply not time. But just another one to kind of mention as well, if you've got data on cloud storage, so that's like Amazon S3 and GCS, Google Cloud Storage, Arrow is kind of optimized for working with data on those services without having to pull it all kind of onto your local machine. But that's all in the docs. And if you're interested in that, either ping me or kind of go check it out. Okay. So one kind of final diagram before we jump into the code, I promise. So we've got this idea then that Arrow can work with different kind of objects, different kinds of file formats, and different kind of storage destinations for this data. And all of these different things can kind of work well together. Okay. So I'm about to jump into code and examples, but before I do, does anybody have any questions at this point? Apparently my flatmate's dog has questions. he's very cute and sat behind me and loves the neighbors next door, but he seems to have chilled out. Okay, I see no questions in the chat. And Cloud is not talking to me in human terms. So let's get into it. Okay. So the data that we're working with today then. This is the Seattle Library Checkout data set. So as Steph mentioned before, it's the one that's mentioned and worked with in the R for Data Science chapter about Arrow. So this is a data set that's from the Seattle Open Data group. It's literally about book checkouts in Seattle from April 2005 to, well, I think 2023, although we might only have up to 2022 in the data set. Okay. So I just kind of opened this, like a subsection of this up in RStudio, because I wanted to kind of give you a feel for what the data set looks like before we jump into kind of working with it. So we've got all these different columns related to the different books that have been checked out of the library. So we've got this column usage class. So that is, it looks like it's whether the book or the thing that was checked out was a physical book or a digital book. We've got checkout type, which I, to be honest, don't entirely understand, but we're not using in the analysis today. This is just what came in the original data. We've got material type. So was it a book? Was it an ebook? Was it a sound disc? Not sure what that is. Maybe that's another word for CD. It is making me think of mini discs, but maybe I need to stay out of the 90s. We've got checkout year, so the year the book was checked out, the checkout month, the number of checkouts. So this is the number of checkouts for that book in that month. And then we've got other data to do with the title of the book, ISBN, which is a unique number to identify every book, and some of the columns that have been cut off, but we're not using them anyway. Okay, so I think now is time to go straight over to our studio. Okay, so I'm just gonna get rid of that there. We've got a new session open, let's do this. So the first thing I'm going to do then is load the Arrow package. And I'm also going to load the plier. We're not using it yet, but if I don't load it now, because we forget to use it later. Okay, so the first thing that I want to do then is let's have a look at this data set. So let's see exactly how big it is. So I'm going to use a base R function called file.size. I'll point it to where I've got the data saved locally. If you're following along and you've got the data saved somewhere else, just make sure to point it wherever you've got it saved. And I know this number is going to be in bytes. So if I divide it by 10 to the power of 9, this will give me the size of the file in gigabytes. Okay, so the file is, 9.2 gigabytes. So yeah, it's a chunky one. So let's work with this. So I'm going to create a new object, Seattle CSV, and I'm going to use this Arrow function called open dataset, and I'm going to point it to that same path where I have that data object saved. And I'm going to break this up just onto separate lines, just so it can all fit on the screen nicely. So when I'm opening a CSV file or a CSV kind of data set, I need to remember to tell Arrow that it's CSV format, because if not, I'm going to get some sort of error message just because CSV isn't the default format. Okay, so I'll run that now. Okay, so that has created a connect, that has opened the data set. So you'll notice that ran pretty fast, and that is because nothing has been loaded into memory yet. So opening a data set, it's a little bit like creating a connection to a database. It's basically saying, okay, the data that we want in our data set is over there in that file. Take a quick look, get a little bit of metadata, which we'll talk about in a moment, but none of that data has been pulled into my R session yet. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is count the number of rows in the data set. So I'm going to use the base R function nrow, Seattle CSV. Now, when I run this, this will take a moment. It's a big CSV file. It needs to take a look at it, scan it, count the rows. There's always the fun thing as well, that because Arrow is using kind of RAM and CPU to do a lot of these optimizations, and Zoom uses a lot of RAM and CPU, it can conflict a bit, but that's fine. Okay, so we have 41.4, if we're rounding it, million rows of data. So again, pretty sizable, right? So let's have a look at that Seattle CSV object that I've just created. Okay, so to make this a bit bigger, so we can take a look at the output here. Okay, so the first thing to note then is this line here. So it says it's a file system data set. So that just means it's a data set. It's literally stored on my local file system with one CSV file. As expected, we pointed it at that one CSV file that we downloaded. And then we've got this output here. So this is what is known as the data set schema. Okay, so a schema is a mapping of column names to types. So we've got usage class, checkout time, and all those other columns that we saw before. Something that you might notice here, though, is that these data types are a little bit different to ones that you might be used to seeing in R. And this is because Arrow has a richer set of data types than R does. So before, when I was talking about interoperability, for Arrow to be compatible with a lot of different systems, it makes sense for Arrow to define its own data types that then are compatible with those systems. So for example, string is the equivalent of an R character object. And int64 is a type of integer. Most of the time, when you're working with Arrow, you don't need to worry too much about this idea of Arrow data types, because Arrow will do this kind of conversion for you. But actually, some of the time, we do need to kind of think about it a little bit. So I'm going to ask you a question now. Looking down this list of kind of column names and data types, is there anything anybody notices in there that's a bit unusual or a bit like, oh, what's that? If anybody's got any idea, let me know in the chat. So years and months. So I'd love you to expand on the years and months things, actually, just so I can talk about that. But yeah, so a few people have mentioned ISBN is null, and that's exactly right. So yeah, exactly. Loads of you have spotted that. Fantastic. So the ISBN, I've written down what it stands for because I can never remember this, International Standard Book Number. So this is registering as null here. Like, what's going on? So what happens is when Arrow looks at a CSV file, and actually when any kind of CSV reader looks at a CSV file, CSVs don't have any content in them that or that tells you up front what the data types are, right? So CSV readers have to kind of look at the data that's there and try to guess what the data types are. This is called type inference. Now, the way it works specifically in Arrow is it takes a look at the first 1 megabyte of data. I can't say in terms of number of rows, and that's because if you've got a different, you know, different data sets with different numbers of columns, therefore we'll have a different number of rows that make up that 1 megabyte. So what's happened here is Arrow has looked at that first megabyte of data, and I know from having seen the data set before that the ISBN number is kind of, it's sparsely populated early on. So actually, I don't think ISBN was populated in that data set until quite a bit further down. So what happens here is Arrow looks at the first megabyte and every value in the ISBN column is blank. So it's got no information to figure out what the type is, and it's put it in as null. Now, I also know from looking at the data set that this column is not null for all of the values. So we need to do something about this. Okay. And just to expand a little bit more on what this null type is, literally the null type is a column that's literally just full of empty values. It's not something that I've tended to use in analyses myself, because I guess I wouldn't have that column in my data. So for me, if I see that there, I feel like, okay, I need to do a bit more work around the schema. Okay. Oh, and that's great, actually. So Steph, you've mentioned not all checkout types will have an ISBN. Yeah, okay, never thought of that. Thank you. Okay, so let's have a look at what we want to do next. So we can look at the schema of our data set by using schema function. So schema, Seattle CSV. Now we're going to see some of the same output that we saw before, because the schema is automatically printed when we print the object itself. Okay, so we say we've got a schema, we've got all those values that we have there. Okay, so what I want to do is when I'm opening this data set, I just want to give Arrow the information that I know about what the schema is of this column. So ISBN, so I know it's a number. I know it can be like 13 digits, but I think sometimes it can be 11 digits. And I know in this data set that there's some extra annotations in there. So I'm going to read it in as a string. So if I copy and paste the code from above, Seattle CSV is open data set. Okay. So the other column types looked fine. So I just want to correct Arrow on the ISBN. So if I do col types equals string, okay. So I'll run that. Oh, so what have I done? Aha, that's it. So I have missed out most of the code on that line. So actually what I need to say is I need to make a sort of mini schema. So col types equals schema, ISBN equals string. So what will happen here now is Arrow will take this kind of partial schema that I've supplied. It'll make sure that ISBN is acknowledged as a string, and it'll still do the same type of inference on all the other columns. Okay, so if I now print this object, okay, and now we have ISBN as string. I'd say in terms of how often do we need to do this, it really depends on your data. Personally, I think it's good practice to kind of explicitly supply the types just so I can be totally sure everything is kind of working as expected. And one other thing as well, obviously these are Arrow data types, and if you've not seen them before, you might not know what they are, but we have seen string. So if I wanted to find the documentation to see what ones exist, I can type in *string. Okay, so the help plot will open up. Okay, so we've got string in the rlang package, which is not the one that we want. And then we've got create Arrow data types, which is the one that we want. So if I click on this, we've got a help page. It talks about all of the different Arrow data types. And if we scroll down, we can kind of see different options there. The Arrow docs do provide a lot nicer kind of explanation of how they map to R types, because I don't recommend just kind of reading through all of these. But if you want a reference of kind of having them all, that's how you can get to them. Okay, so I'm going to recap what we just went through, and then I'm going to have a look and see if there's any questions. Okay, so Okay, so this was our data set, the Seattle library data set. We took a look at the size. It was 9 gigabytes in total. So we opened it in Arrow using the open data set function, and we just had to make sure that we passed in format equals CSV, otherwise we're going to get errors on a CSV file anyway. We counted the rows of data. So there were 41.4 million rows of data. We extracted the schema from the data set, and we saw that the ISBN value was null down here. So I mentioned about Arrow data types, and just this idea that these data types are a bit more expansive than the R data types, but they're all completely interoperable. They've all been mapped to R data types. So yeah, we talked a bit about type inference and the idea that Arrow scans the first megabyte of the data to guess the data types. And actually here, so I've got the kind of data dictionary. And if we take a look at that, we can see down here next to ISBN that, yeah, this is supposed to be a plain text variable. So it's definitely not null. So yeah, it's always worth checking the schema or even just manually supplying it yourself. So we manually supplied the schema using the col types format. Actually, if you're a read R user, if you use the package read R, you might already be familiar with the col types parameter because that's actually implemented in some of the read R functions. We've tried to keep the API kind of consistent with kind of other bits of kind of like the tidyverse and similar APIs. And then that was everything. Okay. So at this point, oh, fantastic. Any questions? I can see there's a few in the chat there. So I'm just going to scroll up and have a look. Yeah, so not all checkout types will have an ISBN, absolutely. Gregory Power, they mentioned that, yeah, months and years, you could use a different data type. So I don't want to get too much into this. Like, usually the defaults are fine. If you wanted to use, so the different integer types, it's all to do with how the largest and smallest possible values of that integer. So you could absolutely have use int 16 instead. I feel like a lot of the time it might not be worth doing that, but yeah, if you've got specific needs to kind of do things like that, absolutely, that could be a great idea. Albury has said, yeah, so I'm afraid, yeah, on Mac there's a little bit of an issue at the moment with CRAN where the binary that's being supplied does not have all of the Arrow features enabled from how they built it. But Steph has put some instructions in the chat there. Basically, the guidance that we're giving is if you install Arrow if you're on a Mac and something doesn't work about data sets, if you use the instructions there to install Arrow from our universe, then it will have a fully enabled build. Yeah. Okay, so then we've got a question from Melissa. In the file folder pane in our studio, the CSV shows up as 8.6 gigabytes, but it shows up as greater than 9 when we use the file.size function. Does using open data set make the file size a bit bigger? Oh, and then we've got a message from Roman. Oh, I think this is to do with, oh my goodness. Okay, this is to do with bytes and gigabytes and the fact that it's not, oh, I don't know, what is it? Like, it's not a million bytes in a gigabyte. It's a number that's a power of 2. If somebody can give a better explanation than me of that would be great. Can we use R's built-in summary function to get a better view of the data set since 1 meg is too small before doing any data cleaning? I don't think we can with summary, but I'll be showing you other ways of kind of previewing bits of the data as well. And we can kind of drop in some comments about the other kind of, there's a lot of data preview functions that are compatible with Arrow dataset. So not summary, but other ones are. Okay. Is there a way to select the columns you want to read in? That's a great question. Can you do me a favor? Can you ask that again after the next bit? Because that will be the perfect time to answer it once I've done a little bit of data manipulation.
Sounds good.
All right. Thank you. I'll forget if I kind of jump around now. How much RAM comparatively does the connection to the CSV use compared to be what it would for memory? I don't know the exact numbers, but I will say the connection uses probably a tiny bit of memory. Whereas if the data was pulled into memory, it would use more or less the file size of the data. I think there's functions in R like object.size or something like that that you can use to test the size of an object in memory. So I'd be curious if you wanted to try that. Oh no, but then you'd load it into memory. Yeah. Natalie, you're still, yeah. Still downloading. Posit Cloud is an option. Okay, cool. All right, so I think I'm gonna pause questions there. I think everyone's had time to look through some things. I'm going to move on in a second, but any dataset related questions will be totally relevant to the next section. So yeah, please keep the questions coming. Okay, we've opened the dataset. We've talked about schemas. So now let's have a look at doing something with the data, right? That's the fun bit. Okay, so data manipulation with Arrow. So earlier I mentioned a few times this idea of this Arrow dplyr backend, or the idea that you can use dplyr functions to work with Arrow. And I want to just briefly kind of explain what exactly I mean by that. So on this diagram, if we kind of look at the left-hand column, so when we're working with just dplyr on its own, working with say a tibble or a data frame in an R session, what's happening there is you're writing dplyr functions, like select, mutate, group by, filter, and the whole kind of list of all the different dplyr kind of verbs and functions. It translates it into something that the dplyr backend can run, and then that runs it on your R object and does your analysis. Now, if you're familiar with the dbplyr package, then just for a bit of context for anybody that isn't, dbplyr is a package that allows you to work with data that's stored in SQL databases, but from R and using dplyr. So again, you're using the same dplyr functions, filter, mutate, group by, all of those same ones. And the dbplyr package translates that, I think, into SQL that can then run on a SQL database, but you don't have to write any SQL code to do that. And it's all the same dplyr functions. And it's kind of the same thing for the Arrow R package. So again, using dplyr functions, filter, group by, et cetera, and the Arrow R package will translate those functions into something that in the back end, the Arrow C++ library can understand, but without you having to interact directly with the Arrow C++ library. And you'll see hints of it in the output, but not a huge amount, because we want to kind of keep that separate so you can keep using dplyr API functions. Okay. So let's pop back into our studio. Okay, so this data set, it contains books, ebooks, sound discs, whatever they are. If anybody knows what a sound disc is, please tell me in the chat. That would be great. I'm fascinated. But actually, let's say I want to do an analysis where I just want to look at books, right? So I'm going to count books as books, audiobooks, and ebooks. And I want to ask questions like, how many checkouts of these books were there each year? Did this change, you know, around 2020 when the pandemic started? So let's take a look at the data. So I'm going to start this off. We'll take the Seattle CSV object. And I'm going to use the dplyr function mutate. And I want to create a new column called isBook. And it's going to have either true if that row is about something that's a book, and false if it's something that isn't a book. The isBook equals, and then I'm going to use this function ends with, so that's a base R function. So it's material type. So if the material type column ends with the letters B-O-O-K. So basically the ends with function returns true or false. So if material type ends with book, it returns true. If not, it returns false. And we'll preview how that looks in a moment. And then actually, if I just want to play around with this query, I don't need all my different columns. So I'm going to use the select function to select material type and is book. Okay. So I'm going to run this. So that returns something really quickly. So this has still not run that code on the data yet. And this is because Arrow uses this idea of this thing called lazy evaluation, which means you can build up these queries with lots of different components in them, But we need to actually tell Arrow, okay, I've made my query, let's go run it and pull the data back into the R session. But before we get to that, actually, I want to just have a little bit of a look at this output here, because I feel like it can be a little bit confusing the first time round. So the first thing here is to know, this is to do with a file system data set. So that same data set we've got saved on a local file system. The object that we've created here is a query. It's a query that's going to run on the data set. And actually, we've got something here that looks a little bit like a schema, and it kind of is. So we've got the material type column, which we've selected here, which is a string. And then we've got isBook. So isBook is a bool. So bool is like Boolean, which is the same as R's logical type. So again, that's true and false values. Now we've got this weird bit of code here that, to be honest, you never need to work with this or know about it, but I just want to explain what it is in the context of the slide that I just showed you. So this is about how the Arrow R package has translated this call here into something that the Arrow C++ package can understand. So we'll notice it's translated this ends with to this ends underscore with, because that's a package, that's a function that's in the Arrow C++ library, and that's just what it's called. It's got a slightly different way of specifying this function, but honestly, if you wanted to never look at this bit of it again, you can get all your data analysis done fine. But just to make the point, this is a kind of representation of that kind of translation. Okay, so yeah, so it's not run anything yet. So at this point, I don't want to run this and pull this data back into my session. Now, if it's probably a reasonable size, like I've taken a 9 gigabyte file and I've just selected a column and created a new column. But actually, what if I was doing this on my full data set, right? And I'm adding a new column to it. I'm still going to have loads of data to pull into memory. So when I'm constructing these queries, one of the things that I like to do is use the head function just to get a kind of preview, a subset of some of the data. And then now I can call collect. So collect is the thing that will pull the data into your R session. So if I not put, yeah, okay. So if I run this now, okay. So it's just doing it on the first 20 rows. So let's just check our query is doing what we expect it to be doing. Okay. So book, true. Yeah. SanDisk has got false. Ebook has got true. Audiobook has got true. So I'm happy with this query. I've written it right. It's doing what I expect it to be doing. Cool. Okay. So let's do something on the whole data set though. So let's look at how many books were checked out each year. So let's take the Settle CSV object. So these are all dplyr functions. I don't need to do a filter though I don't need to do a mutate to create a new column, because what I can do is, if I only want to look at the books, I can use filter. So because this function call here will return true or false, what I'm saying is only return me the rows where material type ends in book. So it's just a slightly more efficient way of getting there. So we've got our data, we're filtering by anything that's a book. I want to group it by checkout year, so we can look at the number of checkouts per year. I'm just going to scroll down a little bit and put a little bit more white space there, so this is higher up on the screen. Let's use summarize. So that's going to be, let's do checkouts equals sum of checkouts. Okay. That is not quite the right character. I'm going to use the function arrange. So arrange will just order my data set by whatever variable I pop in there. So what this will do is it'll just order the returned data by checkout year, so we can kind of go through and look at the trends over time. And then I'm going to collect that into my R session. Now, with this query, because I'm grouping by checkout year, I know that actually the number of rows returned will be the number of different years I have. And I think there's about 17 rows in the data. So I don't need to run head first, because I'm only pulling 17 rows of data into the R session. So it's only worth chucking head into preview a query when that query is going to run on kind of like so much data, but actually return a huge amount of data that would overwhelm the R session. Okay, so let's run that and expand that. So that'll take a moment. Again, because it's going through this whole CSV file, we've got to group by year and get the output. And in fact, while we're waiting for that to run, I'm going to queue up the next thing that I'm going to run. This is always fun. It's every time I do it on Zoom, it takes longer. Okay, we've got it. Okay. So I'll go back to what that is there. Okay, so here we've got our data. So the question of how many checkouts were there per year, and did it change when the pandemic started? So yes. So we start off with 2 million checkouts. It kind of slowly increases to 2019. It drops again. It drops in 2020. I guess less people using the library, right? Everyone's kind of stuck at home. And then it's kind of starts increasing and flattens out again. Okay. So that was running across 42 million rows of data. Okay, now, sorry, I did skip ahead just to run something that I knew was going to take a moment. All that I did is, on top of that query, I just added a pipe into system.time. So system.time, if you have kind of a chain like that and you pipe something into the system.time function, it'll run it and see how long it took to run. Okay, so it took 30 seconds on my computer, which, you know, not bad for nearly 42 million rows of data. But there are ways of making this faster, and we are going to be talking about that in a moment when I hand over to Steph. But first, let's just recap that whole section, answer any questions, any issues anybody had. Let's do that. Okay, so where did we get to? Okay, yeah, so I mentioned this idea that we can use the dplyr API or the dplyr functions to query data that the ROR package translates into something the ROC++ library can understand. So we took a look at constructing a query. So, oh my goodness, that was not the page that I expected to be on. Let's see, where did we get to? Aha, yes. So we constructed a query. So Seattle CSV, we created a new column, is book. And then we looked at the material type in his book. So we get this output here. So the output kind of summarizes the query. So we get the schema of the data that we're expecting to return. And we get this little kind of Arrow C++ library representation of the query we're about to run, but nothing has been pulled into memory. So we can preview the query by calling head further up and then collect further down to only run it on a little bit of our data. So we don't want to pull it all into the R session. We then took a look at the question of how many books were checked out each year. So I had this chain. So we start off with the CSV data set. We filtered by anything that ends in the word book. We grouped it by year. We did this summary that calculates the sum of checkouts, the total number of checkouts for that year. We ordered it by checkout year, just so we could have this in the right order. And then the most important thing, we use collect to pull that back into the R session. So we saw, it went up to all the way up to 2019 and then dropped a little bit. So yeah, it actually took longer than this on my computer at the moment, 30 seconds. But not bad for the data set size, but yeah, we can do this way faster. Okay. So hopefully that made sense. I'm just gonna check your questions now. Okay, yeah, Posit Cloud is a good idea if things aren't downloading. Oh, SoundDisk, old disk used with phonograph. I don't even know what that is, to be honest. Just wondering for dplyr, so it's an ORM for various DB architectures, and then, oh, fantastic. So someone's added a nice link there with some information about that. When using group by an arrow, does arrow maintain the grouping in the same way that dplyr intervals do? Yeah, it does. So let me see if I can, so if I just do Seattle CSV, I don't know if this will be visible in the output that I see, but we can try it. Group by checkout year. Okay, yeah. So in this kind of, again, this preview of the query, it's got a little thing that indicates that it's grouped by checkout year. So that, yeah, if you run more, you know, if you've got more things on that query, it'll maintain that grouping. And yeah. And does summarize drop one grouping variable the same way it does with dplyr? I'm not familiar with that bit of the API, but I do know that in the arrow tests, we have a lot of tests that compare the results against dplyr. So the idea is that the behavior, unless it says anything different in the Arrow documentation, the behavior should be identical to dplyr. That's kind of what we're aiming for here. We want it to be possible to swap from the exact same workflow that using dplyr over to Arrow without getting different results. Any recommendations for avoiding accidentally crashing your R session? Ah, yes, I've done that a few times myself. So Steph's replied, managing how much data you pull into R. Are there settings for capping the RAM that R can access? Unfortunately, there aren't actually. This is something that I was really interested in as a developer working on kind of the Arrow R package and seeing if there were certain things maybe at the C++ level that can be done about this. I think the short answer is that it's more complicated than you think. One strategy that I've used though, I've had issues where there's been a little bit of a bug somewhere and I've been trying to figure out what's going on and I don't want to crash my laptop because it makes me want to throw it out of the window. I think that's laptop defenestration. And I have tried running the same code and everything from a Docker container. I mean, I wouldn't recommend that for everyday analysis. I think the important thing here is just previewing queries and maybe doing a bit of a filter if you're not sure how much kind of data is going to be in that block, just to see how much comes back and kind of maybe iteratively adding some through. I guess with a lot of things like this one with mutate and select, I'd expect to have 42 million rows of data, and that's why I'm a little bit iffy about wanting to just run that. Like, it might work with fewer columns, but it might also use lots of RAM. And with this one, because I'm grouping by checkout year, I know that checkout year has 17 values, so I'm only going to pull 17 values into RAM, but I don't have anything more concrete than that, I'm afraid. Can Arrow cooperate with data table at all rather than dplyr? So some people actually have suggested the idea of implementing like the data table API with Arrow, which I think that would be really cool to see, because you know Arrow is all about interoperability and it would be awesome to let anybody bring any of their kind of tooling to the table and work with Arrow in the back end. It's not something that I've seen anybody work on at the moment, but like it would be really awesome to see. If anybody did want to work on that and submit a pull request, that would be amazing. But I don't think there's anybody working on that at the moment. Okay. Can you talk a bit about using compute versus collect and when it's good to use the former over the latter? I'm loving people putting these great replies before I have to think about it. Yeah, compute does the calculation and collect brings the result into your R workspace. Generally, there isn't a huge amount of need to use compute except for some very specific circumstances. I'm trying to think now of the circumstances, because we did talk about this a little bit in last year's workshop, but we realized because it's quite rare, it's collect is way more the kind of the common thing. But let me, compute doesn't bring things into memory. You're right. It kind of runs the computations depending. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Riker, you've got a hand up?
Yeah, I'm just thinking. So maybe if you have like a multi-step processing workflow and you don't want to do everything in one function and you want to kind of chunk it up into, you know, two or three different functions, you could like the output of, let's say, your first function can be done through compute. So you get an Arrow data object that you can pass on to the next function. Would that be one use case?
I think I'm going to have to double check this and get back to you, but I think it still sort of realizes it an Arrow table actually. So what I'd say is, in the case where you want to pass things around, you can just pass the query that you've already constructed around and do extra things to that query, but in different functions. I think in that case, that might be the better approach, but let me, when Steph is presenting her section, I'm going to double check that for you. Cool. Any other questions about any of that content so far? Cool. So I think that makes a nice natural place to have a little bit of a break. So how about we just take like a 5-minute comfort break and come back. In the meantime, if anybody's got any questions they want to ask, we'll kind of be about. So yeah, thank you. And we'll get started at 5:05. And actually, I'm just going to, I'll keep my screen share on just in case anybody has any other questions while we're in that break. feel like I should play some music, but I don't have any to play.
Nick, do you want to stop screen sharing and I'll jump in?
Fantastic. Sounds good. Oh, just to add an extra point to that compute versus collect. Actually, I'll wait till the end of the break, actually, and then, yeah, give people the chance to get away a sec. Thank you, Steph, for displaying that. So I'll tell you, I'll give everybody an extra minute. And then I'll talk over the compute versus collect thing.
Out of curiosity, is compute a eager versus collect is a lazy execution model?
I don't know really, because they both do stuff, right? They both get Arrow to perform calculations. I think basically, I'll run through the explanation now. So just this slide that's up now is a slide that we used at PositConf in the workshop last year. And this is one of the kind of slightly niche kind of examples of where actually kind of using compute kind of makes sense. So if you've got a grouped summary, and then, so if you've got some sort of aggregation and then you carry on doing stuff in that pipeline, if you want to call the nrow function, in cases where you don't have any kind of aggregation, Arrow kind of knows how many rows of data are going to be returned. And even with filters, it can work it out very easily. But once you've got an aggregation there, what Arrow needs to do is run the aggregation and then kind of do the row counting. So at this point, you might put compute in there to be able to actually get the number of rows out. But if you've got a lot of computation going on, if you've got a lot of rows that are going to be returned from that kind of bit higher up in your aggregation, you can still end up with a lot in memory. But compute calculates it, it pulls it into memory as an arrow table. It doesn't convert it into a data frame or a tibble. An arrow table tends to be a little bit smaller than, it does end up being smaller than a data frame or a tibble, but it's just something that we don't use a huge amount except for some quite specific use cases, which is kind of why we've kind of stepped away from going too much into that this time.
Okay, I'm tracking. So it caches an arrow object as opposed to something in the R API.
Yeah, that's a nice summary of that. Yeah.
So I guess, could you store that calculated R object in on disk or on memory then, as opposed to?
Yeah, so if you've got an arrow table, so an arrow table is like the arrow version of a data frame effectively, but it's all with arrow format and columnar storage. You can write that, you can take that and write that as a CSV file or a Parquet or something else. And I guess if you're really, really pushing against the edges of being able to pull that object into memory, being a table might take it just about small enough to fit, maybe. Again, it's just not a typical use case, but yeah, you can write an arrow table to disk because all the write functions can take an arrow table as an input. Cool. Albury, you've got your hands up.
I just wanted to expand on that a little bit. So like, for example, like right now, this workshop is coming at a perfect time for me. I can't tell you how happy I am. I have this big repository of scripts. It's like 5 scripts or something like that. And I want to hand arrow objects between those scripts. And I have been using compute for that. And I've been wondering like, okay, like why is there so much stuff in my memory if I'm using arrow? And I think it's because, yeah, I've been loading these arrow tables instead of, yeah, so I'm not sure what to do.
I mean, do you want to drop me, I'm trying to think, if you want to drop me a DM, I can see if I can kind of like help, you know, let me know what kinds of things you can, like what kinds of things you're doing in the different scripts. It might be something like not calling collect and passing just the object, the query around, or it could be something else depending on exactly what you're doing.
Right, right. Yeah. Definitely if I call collect, it will crash my computer.
Yeah, at that point, it might be like something to pass the query around, but feel free to kind of, I'm trying to think the best way to do it. Feel free, Steph will talk later about kind of where to add. Feel free to drop an email to the Arrow mailing list or just contact me directly. That's fine.
That would be so awesome. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's all good. Cool. Okay, I think that was all of the questions for now. Will happily hand over to Steph.
Okay, it's 5:09. Is everyone feeling ready to keep going? Thumbs up. All right. So thank you, Nick, for introducing us to some of the theory of what's under the hood with Apache Arrow, and getting us started with one of the most powerful functions in the Arrow for our package, in my opinion, is the open dataset function, because it lets you start to interact with your data without pulling it into memory. And then giving us that kind of great introduction to starting some basic data manipulation and how you might handle using Arrow with that really large data without crashing your computer. And one thing that we didn't add in the slides, we've all had the, if you're an RStudio user, and it sounds like there's a few on the call, you get that really like bomb picture. That's a bit, and I think that's kind of what brings many of us to Arrow, as looking for a solution around that. But I'm going to talk now, part 4 is about engineering the data that we're actually working on with Arrow. I'm not a data engineer, but I had to learn a little bit about in this space, to make some projects that I was working on successful. And that's kind of how I got introduced to Arrow, which is why I've become a bit passionate about data engineering. I'm going to start with this slide just to come back from break and instill a little bit of humor. This is a XKCD comic. I love these comics because they speak to the technical, you know, technical humor, which you can't get everywhere. So, you know, here's an individual at their working away, and a colleague sends them a Word document containing an embedded photo that they took a screenshot with a spreadsheet open, and they're asking if you can use this data. And, you know, I work in the public service, and I'm sure many of you work with data that doesn't always come in ideal formats or ideal APIs or designs. And, you know, I think this is just one thing that is just never going to go away, is that it really does start with file, or success often starts with file formats, and how fast we can get going turning data into insights starts with the shape of the data. We're going to talk about a file format that was that might be new to some of you, or maybe you're already using them, called Parquet. Nick alluded to this in the introduction. I'm just going to get my notes here so I do Parquet justice. So Parquet is actually another open source project, and it's a open source project that's created a column oriented data file format, really from the ground up designed for efficient data storage and retrieval. So the kind of crux of Parquet is it's really designed for being optimal for being on your disk, and really, really quick and optimal for going and getting and fetching that data. It supports multiple languages, including Python, C++, and R. And so for those of us who work on Python and R teams, which is increasingly common, Parquet is great because everyone on your team can use it. And I think while CSVs continue and probably always will be a really popular format, I think there you might see that Parquet is a very popular format for larger data sets or larger than memory data sets. And I think it's growing in popularity and use across all sectors. All right, so let's talk a little bit about what's happening in a Parquet file. So Parquet files are row chunked. I love that word. Probably because I like chocolate chunk cookies is why it resonates when I say that out loud. But what do we mean by row chunked? So there's a table on this slide, which is something that most of us will recognize with columns and rows. And what it basically means is in the Parquet file, it's not stored as a continuous table, but it's actually stored as chunks of rows. And what does that mean? It means that when your computer is interacting with that Parquet file, it means that it can work on different chunks at the same time, so kind of in parallel. So that's obviously for those of us who are, you know, like that can increase speed and efficiency. Or super importantly, it can skip some chunks altogether. So if you're working on a giant set of data and there's parts of that data that you don't even need to touch, then you know, Parquet you can just ignore those sections of the Parquet file. You'll also hear Parquet files described as row chunked and column orientated. And so kind of like Arrow in itself, those chunks, instead of being stored in rows, are flattened and stored in a column. And really the take home for that, I'm not a computer scientist, but is that current modern hardware of our computers and all of that vectorization goodness that's happening under the hood can really goes faster when things are in those column formats, when they're stored on your disk in a column format than in a row format. So that's another big kind of takeaway that's different from a CSV, which is something, or Excel, which is something that people are probably working with a lot as well. Yeah. So kind of the big pieces, this is not everything about Parquet, but as someone who's, you know, working with Parquet mostly in a data science workflow, here are some of the big pitch for trying out this file format, is that it's that compression and the encoding of the file usually makes it much smaller on disk. So if you're hanging out with data engineers or people who are paying for your data storage, it would probably make good friends with them if you told them that they can save storage space. And it also means less like physical data to move back and forth from disk to memory, so it can be more efficient. Nick talked a lot about the schemas and data types and the different systems between Arrow and R. What's really magical, and I think it is the word magical is the right word about Parquet, is that the schema is stored with the data. So how many people in the chat, somebody, like, have you had something go in your analysis or pipeline where you had the wrong data type inferred by your CSV reader. I think everybody must experience this at some point. It took me a really long time in my career to realize that this was a kind of a weak link. So the nice thing about Parquet is that those data types that, you know, come from your data engineer or are stored with the data, and then the row, chunk, and column oriented bits make the file kind of designed for fast and efficient data pipelines. Okay, I'm just going to take a quick look at the comments. My first time I had pandas. Yeah, some hands raised. So it's got some folks who have had similar experiences. All right. So what I'm going to do now is open up. I've got, does everyone see RStudio now?
Yep.
Yeah. So I've got RStudio with a new session. And I've kind of like followed along with some of Nick's code. So I'm just going to run this bit of code here, which was loading the libraries arrow and dplyr, and loading that Seattle CSV, which is pointing to that object, which obviously I haven't brought into memory because I don't want 9 gigabytes of data. And then I'm going to rerun this chunk that Nick ran at the end of your section, which optimistically, I'm saying it's going to take about 10 seconds on my MacBook Air. We'll see. But while that's happening, I am going to have us write out, convert this. Oh, so yeah, look at that, 11 seconds. So
you've got
fast.
A better laptop than me.
Yeah. But it's still, you know, it's like that's like 10 seconds. I get distracted in about 3 seconds. So that's a lot of time to get distracted while that's running. So we are going to take this CSV data that we downloaded from that bucket, and we're going to turn it into a Parquet file instead of a CSV file and start to figure out what is all the fuss about Parquet. So I'm going to start by making a directory. Dot data so that it goes in the right spot. A new directory for our data, and I'm just going to call it Seattle Library Checkouts Parquet. So hopefully that works. All right, so I'll run that. Great, I've got a directory to send the data to. And then we are going to write out that Seattle data, Seattle CSV. I'm just going to pipe that object, which is our data, our object that we've read in from the CSV data. We haven't imported it yet. So this is actually a powerful thing, is that we can convert this data, the file from a CSV to a Parquet, without actually reading the data into your laptop, which is sometimes a really handy thing to be able to do. And we're going to use a new function, or a new to us function today, called write dataset. So this is the partner of read dataset, or open dataset, sorry, open dataset in the arrow. And it allows us to write data out using arrow. So I'm going to give it my path, Seattle, Parquet, directory. And I'm going to tell it that I want Parquet instead of something else. Boy, my screen is all right. So this is going to take a little bit of time because we're writing 9 gigabytes of data, or was it 42 million rows of data? But I'm going to hit run, and while this is happening, you can ask some questions. Maybe people can let me know if you've used Parquet before. Maybe there's some Parquet fans, super fans in the audience. Or maybe there's some folks who are not fans. And Gregory, you want to unmute yourself?
Sure. So I guess one thing, I know we're getting to speed up just because of the whole localization thing, but so you're telling me I don't have to have this be written in batches in memory? And I can just load CS transform from CSVs to Parquets?
Well, with my laptop, I just took that CSV. I'm just going to show everybody that was 8.6 gigabytes in my file pane, and I just wrote it to this Parquet folder in a Parquet file, 4 gigabytes, and I have 16 gigabytes of memory on my laptop. So I'm pretty sure that it is not, well, I don't know. Nick, do you want to help me out here? I don't, it's not bringing the whole file into memory. Obviously it has to bring in batches.
So, do you know what? It's interesting really talking about this one because I can answer the question better if we've got partition data, which we'll be looking at later. I am not sure, but I do know that the way a lot of this works under the hood is that it can pull the data out in kind of like chunks at a time, effectively. Chunk is not the correct terminology here, but it doesn't have to pull it all in. It can do it kind of bit by bit as it's kind of reading and writing it.
But great question, Gregory. You're definitely pushing our computer science literacy. Please unmute yourself. Go again.
Cool. I guess I got a follow-up for that. So do you usually find a performance improvement for databases that support the AB, sorry, the AB, it's instead of OBDC, it's ABDC, the like feather transmission. Sorry, I'm
So
not phrasing that question right. It's the, I know it's affiliated
ABDC
with the arrow.
is the arrow driver, is the new arrow protocol. I haven't used it, but my understanding is that there are some significant performance gains over ODBC under certain circumstances anyways.
Yeah, a lot of the time when you're using those kind of analytical rather than transactional workloads, you can see it. But to be honest, I'm not super familiar with a lot of ADBC stuff because, well, simply I didn't work on that. I did a lot more kind of to do with this kind of file-based kind of data set operations, really.
So on my laptop, I hope it's worked for others. I've written this data, this 9 gigabytes of data, as a Parquet file, and it's stored on my laptop and comes up as 4.1 gigabytes. So less than half the size of storage for the same amount of data. And then I'm going to be lazy and I'm just going to grab, well, first I'll sit. So now I want to read that data back in from that Parquet file and rerun our query and see what happens. So I'm going to go open data set. And sources, and I'm going to give it that file directory where the data is sitting, spelled correctly, Seattle Parquet directory. I'm going to tell it to expect Parquet this time instead of a CSV. And then I'm going to pipe in our same nice little query that Nick built. And measure the amount of time. So it should be the exact same thing that we're doing. Oops, highlight that. And I'm going to run that. And it took my laptop less than a second. So really one of the biggest pieces, and again, this is sort of a toy, it's a big data set, but it's still a toy data set. There will be folks on the call that I'm sure are working with many more rows than 42 million. And so you can imagine how much this can scale for you when you're working on billions of rows in terms of really rather than minutes or tens of minutes, you're down to minutes or seconds. All right, so I'm going to flip back to the slides and just give like one more push for trying out Parquet if you haven't already, or chatting with your colleagues who are struggling with really, really large CSV files that you're maybe trying to pass around or trying to use for programs and thinking about whether Parquet might be something to explore. And so, yeah, I'm just going to review. So we wrote to Parquet using the write dataset function, sending it to a folder, the part, and then Parquet file. I didn't live code this, but then you can have a look and compare that Parquet versus the CSV size on disk, which is about half the size. So huge savings of storage. So even for me with my laptop, if I want to hold some of these large data sets just for use, I can run out of memory pretty quick. And so storing them as Parquet files is ideal. And then running this same analytic pipe, the same query, using the Parquet file instead of the CSV file. For my laptop, I went from 10 or 11 seconds to just under a second. So much, much better. But it could be even faster. So we're going to do one more engineering 101, or I call it DIY engineering. And that is how we actually store the data on disk or file storage. And we are going to learn a little bit about partitioning. And so basically partitioning is taking your single data file, or instead of storing data in a single data file, you store it in smaller data files smaller data pieces in folders to make it more accessible and more manageable. This is actually quite common in a lot of databases and database software. For those who, you know, have used like Hadoop and other of these sort of, Spark, you might be familiar with partitioning. So I thought we'd start with a poll. How many folks on the call have partitioned your data before or used partitioned data before today or heard about partitioning? And if you're really lucky, you can type the number 3 because you've got a data engineer that does everything for you. Lots of ones. It's great. Oh, I love this. Melissa, a note for the StatsCan folks, Parquet saves a lot more than double the space when comparing between some OSAS 7B DAT files. Cool.
Yeah, that's a great point, actually, because the amount of space things take up in a Parquet file, it varies so much based on the data types in your original data. And I actually, because this has got a lot of string data in this data set. And I think actually this is probably the least efficient compression. And once you've got integers and things like that, it gets just so much smaller from there.
Same with data, yeah. So, I mean, I think in a lot of companies and organizations, to be honest, I wonder if the Parquet discussion doesn't come up because of storage costs and moving. And also in workflows and spaces where you're moving a lot of data like around, then obviously keeping that data as small as possible is really helpful. Wow. All right. So lots of folks are in the 1 and 2, so a really good mix. I don't think I saw a single number 3. That's a little bit depressing, sad, but maybe we'll all become data engineers and get jobs and do this for people in the future. All right. Oh, so we're going to rewrite the data one more time. So instead of a single Parquet file, we are going to partition this Parquet data. So I'm going to start by making another folder or another directory to put my data one more time. I think this time I'll just call it Seattle Parquet Partitioned. Backslash data, and this time I'll call it Seattle, just library checkouts. All right, so I'm gonna run that. Oops. Hopefully that worked. And then I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna take that Seattle CSV data, or the data that we imported from the Seattle CSV, and this time, so we need to figure out, well, wait a second, I want to make a bunch of pieces of data. I want to make a bunch of small data files. So usually you partition on something that's sort of a natural break for the data. And one that's really, really common is like a temporal variable. So year or month. If you work with environmental data, it can be station, monitoring station. So it can be whatever is the most relevant for your analytic pipelines. But for today, we are going to group our data before we write it using dplyr by checkout year. And I think this kind of relates to some of the questions. As soon as I group it, that group sticks around and it impacts the way that write data set writes our data onto disk. So same thing as before, we're using write data set. I'm gonna give that path, the new path. Nothing to type today. The new path, Seattle Parquet partitioned. I need it, and I want to say format equals Parquet again. Nothing different. It's still going to be Parquet files. The way that write data set knows it's going to be partitioned is because I'm sending in a group data, and I'm going to run that. And it's going to take a little bit of time again. So we'll just take a breath, lower our shoulders, relax, get back in our chairs, drink our coffee that we don't have because it's too late in the day. Okay, mine is done. So there's my checkouts folder. And so when we go and have a look, instead of having that one Parquet file that we worked with, I have a whole bunch of folders, one for each year from 2005 to 2022. And when I click on that, I have a small bit of data for that year, so 100 megabytes. So there you go. We have per you have for those who have never done this before, you've just become a data engineer. You've just changed the data storage, design, and file type all in three lines of code. All right, so what we're gonna do now, again, is okay, well, what happens when we read in that data and do a bit of analysis on it? We wanna open dataset again, and this time we wanna point to the new folder, the new directory, Seattle, Parquet partitioned. I'm gonna tell it that it's Parquet files. I should say that the default, pretty sure, the default for open data set is actually Parquet file. Is that correct, Nick? I've trained myself to always
yes.
put in format. I've trained myself to always put in format so that I never have an issue, but I believe if you are coding really quickly and just want to open something, the default for open data set is actually format Parquet, so you don't need the argument if you know you're opening a Parquet file.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
That's right, okay. But we're gonna just do everything by the book and not take shortcuts. All right, so I've got that same query that you know, so we're gonna, you know, filter and group by and summarize and arrange and compute. How come I'm not collecting? That's funny. Did I compute or collect? Well, I'll just stick with compute for the timing and then should work for both. All right, and I'm gonna run that. And now I'm down to 0.7 seconds. So not as huge of a change, but we've shaved off a few more seconds. And again, if you're working with billions of rows of data, that can turn to minutes and tens of minutes. All right, and I'm actually, since we have time, what I'm gonna do is, because I noticed when we did this one, is that if we actually filter, I think where partitions really start to shine is if you know in your workflows you're gonna be filtering by those partitions. So let's do a similar analysis here, where we open that same partition data, but we, actually I'm gonna copy all of this and then I'm gonna edit it. So instead of just filtering by ends with material type, I'm going to filter by checkout year and just pull one year, 2020. Everyone pulls 2020. And then I'm going to group by checkout month instead of year because we should only have one year, capital, in case, sum of checkouts, and then I'll arrange that by checkout month. So just a bit of a change on the fly here. So now we're going to filter just for one year in this huge data set. And then look at the months and what happens when I do that. So that's 0.06 seconds. And if I take that same query, but used Seattle, I'm scared to do this, Seattle CSV, and what will happen? How long do we think that's gonna take? Anyone wanna guess? So now we did, it was 0.0 seconds, 6 seconds on partition Parquet, and now I'm running it on that. Yeah, so 11 seconds on the CSV, on what we read in from the CSV. So a lot faster. Okay, so I'm gonna go back to our slides just to review. So we rewrote the data one more time, this time as a partition Parquet files. It's the same amount of data, but just divided up into those small pieces. And when I reran it, I with the same query that we've been using for the last hour and a half, I got even more time savings, not as much as switching to Parquet in the first place, but definitely a little bit more efficiencies. Yeah, and so let's talk a little bit about partitioning. So I think there's lots of questions that we can go through, but I think there is a little bit of an art and science of partitioning in that, like, you know, what is the optimal set of partitions? And so some general rules of thumb is you really don't want those pieces or those partitions to be too small. So they shouldn't really be less than 20 megabytes. And of course, as soon as they get to be too big, then you're kind of right back into the larger than, you know, the large data problem. One of the reasons that you don't want them to be too small is that every Parquet file has a little, I call it a footer. Nick can jump in if that's not the right, but it actually has a bit of metadata with it that holds the schema and kind of holds a bit of details about that. So the more that you have to touch, when Arrow looks in the folder, it does touch every file to grab that little bit of metadata, even if it doesn't have to read it. So the more files you have, the more Arrow has to work, even if you're not using them in your pipeline. And so that's the next bullet, which is avoid more than 10,000 files if you can. And then as I showed at the end there, really trying to partition on variables used in filter. So that's relevant to your analysis and designing that partitioning in a way that works best for whatever pipelines you're building. And then, yeah, I finished up with a little bit of like a performance review. If you have that single CSV, and in this case, I actually open it right from the CSV, open data set, 1 9-gigabyte CSV, run, you know, a little query where we're just grabbing 1 year, or maybe you can run it by grabbing a few years. And it took my laptop 11 seconds. And then when I do the same analysis, but looking at using partition Parquet data, I drop that to a fraction of a second. Yeah. So engineering data tips for improved storage and performance. I should really rename this DIY engineering data tips. Use Parquet over CSV if possible. I mean, I'm not here to throw shade at CSVs. When I get a clean machine readable CSV, I'm usually pretty happy when if that's what's getting sent to me. But when you start to work in the larger than memory data space, Parquet definitely has a lot more to offer for data science workflows. You can consider partitioning, and then, you know, maybe doing some experimentation to get the appropriate partition design for whatever workflows, you know, that you're building out. And then because I was using my part of the demo was using Parquet, I didn't have to talk about schemas and I didn't have to deal with column types because they come with Parquet, which is one thing that I love about them. But in general, when you're building out those workflows, really watch your schemas, especially when you're doing CSV to Parquet conversions. And I'll put a plug for always reading the data dictionaries to help you watch those schemas. All right, let's just stop for some questions. Let's see the chat. See lots. Okay, about finalizing the partition key. So yeah, one thing I said about the partitioning key is like really trying to think a little bit about what you're most likely to be filtering and using, you know, what columns are you actually are and data are you actually using in your queries, I think it helps bring the most ideal partition keys. How important is Melissa, you have a question there. I don't know if you want to add to it about the benefits between Parquet versus partition Parquet, or has it already been answered?
I think that's okay. Yeah, it's a common scenario where like I want to be able to partition by a variable that I'll be filtering on, but I can't because doing that would require being able to like bring that into R first. And I'm usually working with SAS files at work. So I have like, it has to be small enough to bring into RAM. But yeah, like our workaround is basically just partitioned by rows instead of by variable. And it definitely does still work. But I was just wondering like how important it is to do the partitioning by variable.
Well, I mean, I think the answer is even in some of the demo, right? Like there wasn't the biggest gain in this particular workflow with 42 million rows was definitely switching from CSV to Parquet by far. That's the first thing. You know, the partitioning where when we didn't filter on year, which was our partition variable, it gave us a few, you know, a little bit more efficiency, but certainly not the same order of magnitude. You know, I think it just depends on the scale of data that you're working with and how much data that you can leave behind. I think Reiko had commented on like, if you don't need columns and you don't need rows, then just leaving them behind is your most efficient strategy. And letting the computer figure out what to leave behind before it pulls it into R.
That makes sense. Thanks.
What is the performance comparison between Feather and Parquet? Yeah. Feather, I don't have an answer. I haven't been working with Feather, which is kind of the Feather 2 is now called Arrow, the Arrow file format. Is that right, Nick?
Yeah. So the Feather story was an interesting one because I think in the early days of Feather, it was kind of like a really cool thing for, you know, kind of it had a lot in common with what we now use Parquet for, and was a lot kind of looking at, you know, we might use Parquet in a certain circumstance or Feather in a different circumstance. But actually, as the kind of Parquet format has kind of developed and Arrow working with it, generally, like I think in 99% of use cases now, we say like use Parquet, because there's a certain point where you're doing benchmarking and comparing things, and you just get to certain bottlenecks where there's no real advantage to using Feather in most cases. Like Parquet is the way forward.
Yeah, great question. There was a question about revisiting selecting the columns. And so I think what's why it might have felt like we didn't actually visit it is that, of course, what we're used to when you just want to bring in a few columns with, say, like read underscore CSV is that you would actually you know, use an argument to say which columns you actually wanted to bring in or leave behind. Where in the case of using open data set, because you're not reading in all the data, you read in all the column headers, and then you use select to say these are the ones that I actually want to work with. So you're actually kind of dropping them in the pointer object rather than dropping them, ever actually explicitly dropping them in your R session. Yeah, so it's a little bit of a funny headspace, I think. Dave, do you want to unmute yourself?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yep.
Perfect. First of all, thanks for putting this on. This was great. Thank you both to Nick and to Steph for the excellent presentation. I had a question with regards to using the active bindings in R and putting those directly into an analytical process. For instance, like running a linear regression on an Arrow data set. I'm just wondering if that's something that's possible. For instance, if we were interested in like the fitted value of a regression using a big data set, is that something that Arrow is capable of doing? Or is it mostly just sort of limited to just sort of like data transformation and conversion and stuff like that?
Yeah, so I know some people have mentioned kind of those kind of like more modeling type approaches and looking into that, but that isn't something that at the moment is something you can do with Arrow. It's but getting everything kind of wrangled to the right shape is definitely where it shines.
Okay, thank you.
Great question. All right, there was a couple more good questions. How do other tools like DuckDB and Spark fit into the conversation about Arrow? Can they all be used together in the same project? And are there scenarios in which one makes more sense than the other? Really, really good question. Thank you, Melissa. Nick and I were talking about this morning. I think what I would say is, so Apache Arrow, and Nick did a brilliant job, but it was almost 2 hours ago, so I'm just going to refresh everyone. Like Apache Arrow at its first level is a standard, which sounds so boring, but is not at all boring. right? Like, because if we didn't have this standard around the, you know, about how we're storing data and moving data around, then all of these amazing advances that we've seen over the last few years with DuckDB, with the Arrow for R package, for some of us who are using proprietary tools that have started to bring in Arrow methods or making things faster. So I think Snowflake has brought in, you know, support for Arrow and other tools like that. It's all around everyone agreeing that the standard was a good way to go. So I just want to start there. It's like Apache Arrow has been wildly successful. However, at the same time, because we have development happening in different ecosystems and different places, we do have a situation where you can do similar things with different tools at this state of the game. So some of the things that we've demonstrated here with Arrow, I think I'm going to say there was a new package that was sort of unveiled this week called Duck Plier, which looks fantastic, which you can sit on top of DuckDB. So really highlight, look at, you can, you know, and DuckDB itself can sit on, you know, can bring in Parquet files. I don't think it can't, Nick and I were talking this morning and we don't think it can deal with partition data, but it can deal with a large CSV or large Parquet file. And they are all using the Arrow standard. So they're using all of this columnar chunked goodness that we talked about that make things faster for everybody. And the Arrow package, for the Arrow R package, we didn't demo it today, but there's actually a two DuckDB function that in the middle of your pipeline, you can be like, actually, there's something I need out of DuckDB that is not incorporated in Arrow. So you can go to DuckDB, do a couple of lines, and then go back to Arrow and make use of both of those analytic engines in the same pipeline. It's quite amazing. So yeah, some workflows, you might want both. Depending on how the data is served up to you and already engineered, it might make more sense to use DuckDB. Or it might make sense to use Arrow on top of Parquet files. And I think it's just really the space to watch. It's one thing I would recommend if you're on a team and you're really trying to work it out, is know that you're in a fast space in terms of development and changes and improvements. Sorry, that was a bit long.
Just to add to that as well, thinking about Spark as well, the thing that I've seen most from other people is when they've got data that's in a Spark cluster, and especially in larger organizations where you've got different people dealing with different bits. And I see it quite common that people will get these Parquet files from Spark, but their bit of the pipeline involves wanting to analyze something kind of locally. And that's where they end up using Arrow. But yeah, these, like, as Steph just said, these things fit together well.
Yeah. All right, I'm just going to finish off with just a couple of minutes of where you can go to next. So the Arrow docs, the Arrow R package has a package down website, which hopefully is sort of a familiar design for R users. What's a little bit different, in my opinion, about this package website is that there's a large number of articles that have been sort of contributed by the community and improved over time around, hey, I want to use cloud storage with the Arrow for R package. What do I do? You know, a little bit, a deeper dive into the dplyr syntax and what's supported, what verbs are supported and not supported. So really recommend going into the website and a couple years ago, like a deep dive into those Arrow data types and Arrow data objects, which a lot of us, we discussed a lot today, are there. A lot of the content that we delivered today is summarized in the 23rd chapter of the R for Data Science 2E, or reasonably new edition, by Hadley Wickham, Mine Sitinkaya Rundell, and Garrett Goldman. So recommended. It's available online to read that chapter. So if you want. And then I'm going to leave it to Nick to wrap us up, because there'll be a new resource for helping out with scaling up with R for Arrow very soon.
Yeah, so thanks, Steph. I and a couple of other Arrow devs are in the process of writing a book, Scaling Up with R and Arrow. We hope that the online preview we're getting to almost being at the point where that's going to be ready to just open that up to the community and get some feedback and people's input. I'm really excited about this. So yeah, please, keep an eye out for that. And we'd love any feedback about any of the content that you have once we've got it there. But it'll be expanding on kind of all the things from the workshop and more. Basically, everything that you could ever want to know about working with Arrow in R, not the C++ side, just the R side. So yeah, thank you. And yeah, I think that's everything. So yeah, thank you everybody for coming along. Yeah, we hope, you know, this has helped answer a lot of your Arrow questions. And yeah, thanks for having us, R-Ladies Ottawa.